We hope you're enjoying not just lunch, but one another's company, and we hope that you've been able to go to as many sessions as fit into what we know are your incredibly busy schedules these last days before classes begin. Today we are highlighting the winners of two of our wonderful CTRL awards. I'll introduce the first of the recipients, who will speak first, and then after the first recipient speaks, I will introduce the second recipient. But before I do that, what I'd like to do is just remind you about what all those pieces of paper on your tables are. You may say, doesn't CTRL really believe in going green? You betcha. But enough research, not just my own, but lots of other people's, shows that if you see something in front of your nose, you are more likely to look at it than if we just give you a URL and say, when you're on your device, go look this up. So I will really quickly go through what you have sitting here, and in a quite appropriate fashion, I will begin with getting your course certified so that you can be a green teacher. This is a program that Anna Olson, who is also responsible for making these workshops go along with her staff and everybody who's speaking at them. But the Green Teaching Program is one that Anna has created. She has received a university award for recognizing her good work here. A number of other universities around the country are emulating our program. So I urge you to go to that URL or just go to the CTR webpage. You can find us. And get your courses certified with 1, 2, 3, or 4 green apples, depending upon how green your course is. For those of you interested in online or hybrid learning, which I bet is a bunch of you, CTRL runs a course, and the people who teach it are sitting here, Laura March and Jim Lee, and we have some help from various friends, but those are the two main anchors for that program. We offer a course each semester, and if you're interested, that's the handout to look for, and there are materials online. You can go ahead and register for one of the sessions. I warn you, they fill up really fast. It's a terrific course. You will learn an incredible amount, and your teaching will enliven in so many ways because of it. The small one has many things on it, including general activities of our research support group. Would everyone from the research support group please raise a hand? I see Asen, I see Eric, I see many of our wonderful consultants, some of whom are new, some of whom I'm welcoming back. Jim is sitting here as well. You will find, if you open this up, this huge number of workshops that we offer on various kinds of quantitative and qualitative and survey research and data visualization programs. So I welcome you to take a really serious look at them. Learn something you don't know anything about. Learn more about something you do know something about. You have a research project you want some help on. Boy, do we have a wonderful group of people to give that assistance. A flyer that looks a little bit like a quilt, designed by Lucas Regner, who is sitting back there. Ta-da, who gave a workshop this morning as well. It's a new initiative that the Center for Teaching, Research, and Learning, along with the University Library and the Office of Campus Life, is putting together to look at ways to help reduce the cost of course materials. Textbooks are getting really expensive. Online software is getting really expensive. There are many kinds of open educational resources, either that are already available or that you may be creating yourselves, as is happening at a number of university campuses. And if you're interested in the initiative, take a look at the flyer. Lucas is the person to contact. And while you're at it, contacting Lucas, the next one I happen to come upon in my pile, mobile learning at AU. Some of you, options for everyone. Some of you remember last year at this time, we had a launch of the mobile learning initiative that is joint between CTRL and the Office of Information Technology, again, the University Library, University Communications and Marketing. And we made available grants last year for people who were interested in doing something creative in their teaching with mobile technologies. Once again, you have that opportunity. The flyer tells how to get started. You'll find more information on the CTRL website. If you want to ask questions, Lucas is the man to go to. We are always looking for nominees for awards, including, Teaching with Research and the Milton and Sonia Greenberg Scholarship of Teaching and Learning Award. from whom we have last year's winners making presentations today. The information with a nice laurel wreath will tell you what you need to do to nominate your colleagues. Unfortunately, you cannot nominate yourself. You can find a friend to nominate you. Did I say that? But we have wonderful, wonderful nominations because we have such a terrific faculty doing incredibly good work. From the Teaching and Learning Resources Group, many workshops. You'll find the list of them in the back. Depending on which you want to take is front and back. On one side, a list of the workshops. On the other side, you'll find a description of what those workshops are, a list of workshops of the, well, that's the same one. Boy, I must have really liked it. Okay. And if there's anything else on the table, please read it. It's all really good stuff. It's my pleasure now to turn to the real reason why we are sitting here today, namely to both honor and hear from winners of some of the awards that CTRL is very privileged to administer. The first of those awards is the Milton and Sonia Greenberg Scholarship of Teaching and Learning Award. Milton Greenberg, as some of you know, is a former provost of the university. He cares very much about the institution. He cares about teaching and learning and the scholarship thereof, and therefore has made available this very terrific award to honor faculty who are doing the things that we do, particularly the scholarship thereof on how we teach and learn. The winner this past year is Professor Terry Larkin from the Department of Physics. And I will just read why you got selected. The short version, so we'll have more time to hear from you. Professor Larkin is an internationally recognized expert in education and assessment with a special focus on STEM education, which most of you know the meanings of, but it's science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, on STEM education for college students in non-science degree programs. She wins this award for her research on writing-based pedagogical methods and her efforts to acknowledge learner diversity, her success, I should say, in acknowledging learner diversity through learning styles and other classroom assessment strategies, as well as the assessment of active learning technologies inside and outside of the STEM classroom. So, Terry, it is an honor to have you tell us about the wonderful work you do.
Well, I want to thank CTRL and my colleague, Nate Harshman, for nominating me for this award. It really means a lot. And I thought that I would talk to you more about the teaching aspect rather than talk about the research that went into the design of the activities that I do in my classes. I thought I'd just talk about the activities that I do. I thought that might be more appropriate given the audience and given the fact that we're all getting ready for classes and it's crunch time to get the syllabi done, and maybe there'll just be something that, you know, that will spark some interest, or maybe just even a cup of coffee later on in the semester. So I know that I'm going to be moving pretty quickly through some slides, and I do want to tell you, especially if you're new to campus, the physics department is in the Sports Center Annex, which is that small metal building that's Velcroed to the back of the Sports Center. Okay. And my office is just inside the back door, right opposite the basketball courts. And the coffee is literally always on there, and you are welcome. One of the reasons I like talking to colleagues is so I have an opportunity to meet some new folks and hear from you, because I learn more just having coffee with a colleague than I do, I think, just about any other way. And so I really would like, if you know any of you want to pop in to scan later on, you're more than welcome to look me up, and I'll be happy to share some coffee with you and some conversation. I wanted to just talk to you a little bit today about a couple of activities that I do in my class. I'm going to be showing you actual work that students have completed with their permission. Photographs are used with students' permission also, so just if anybody's wondering about that. So I'm going to tell you, I want to focus on one course that I have a writing activity that involves a conference paper and actually a formal conference that I have my students do. That's Physics 200. It's a second level gen ed course for it's for non-majors, and a course that I developed and first taught in 1999, and have been doing it in the spring semesters ever since. So I'll tell you a little bit about the conference paper project. I threw in a little bit on assessment. We're all learning about learning objectives and goals and all of that. And then I want to tell you what I do with this course that's different. In fact, I could have called this presentation, the conference paper versus the final exam, okay? Because this really takes the place of a more traditional pencil and paper exam. And then at the end, I threw in a bonus track. So if we have time, it's like this, the extra video that you get when you buy the CD. If we have time, I'll tell you a little bit about a writing activity that I'll actually be using in my classes this semester. Okay, thank you. So what is the motivation for my project doing some writing in the classroom? I spent so much time working with non-majors, and I came to American to work with non-majors. I do classroom research in physics education, and I tend to find that that's a population of students that within the broader research community just sort of gets swept under the rug or forgotten about, and so I've made it sort of my mission to teach science to folks that aren't particularly interested, are just taking it because it's their gen ed, what they're taking for their gen ed. In addition, and this is how I was taught, and these workshops and things are all about learning different ways of reaching out to our students. And so as I started teaching, and I've been in, I'm finishing up my 30th year here this fall, I continue to ask myself, what is it, am I giving an activity just for the sake of giving an activity so I can have my students have a score on something? Or is there really a bigger purpose to this? And what am I actually measuring when I write an exam or give them a test or a quiz or whatever? I find that traditional exams really just give us a small marker in time and about a small segment of material. They really don't give us a way to really uncover what's happening inside the heads of the learner. So I have tried to develop some writing activities that allow me to more formatively and more authentically assess what's going on in terms of what the students are actually learning. And I'll talk about authentic assessment a little bit in a few minutes. In addition, I think that one of the goals, and there's so much research in my field on preconceptions, misconceptions, because students come into a physics class in particular with 18 years at minimum of life experiences. And they have certain notions about basic concepts and speed and force and things like that. And if those notions have never been challenged, then they hang on to those notions until they are challenged. And so if you've hung on to something for 18 years and then all of a sudden that notion gets challenged, that's very uncomfortable. And so it's very important, I think, in order to get students past that feeling of being uncomfortable to being comfortable and really feel like they've been able to understand a concept, to sort of be a part of that process. And so I've found that using a little bit of writing really allows me to do that. So here's my class. It's a class that, it's a three-credit class. I won't explain the time of the course. I meet twice a week. Once is a 75-minute block. The other is a 150-minute block. I was able to get that approved back in 98 when I proposed the course. And I'm using a rather modified studio workshop type format with the class. Students don't do traditional labs, but they do an awful lot of hands-on activity, nor do they do any report writing like they would do in the first level course that I'll actually be teaching in the fall. So you can see the sort of things that students are doing. We're dissecting a light bulb there. They're playing with color. That must have been a standing waves activity. And they're working together as teams. And one of the things that I do with the teams is we change them up all the time, and nobody goes home early. So if a team gets done and finished, they turn into TAs, and they have to work with their classmates and help them progress through the activity so we can sort of stay on pace. So we all know about language of assessment, and we're all working on writing our learning goals and coming up with ways to assess those learning goals in terms of writing learning outcomes for our students. I'm not going to read this to you because this is stuff that's all on your plates right now. And there are a couple different types of measures. Most of us use direct measures that directly, and I'll show you some examples on the next slide. And then there are indirect measures that, you know, maybe a student's on an internship and we're looking at a report from a supervisor or something as sort of a secondary method of assessing what students are learning. Typically what we see is, next slide please, you know, exams and quizzes, especially in a physics or a science class. There's a lot of, you know, homework and things like that. So to take on a writing-based project within a physics class is a little bit outside the box, I think, in the first place, because it's not what its students are necessarily expecting that they're going to be doing in a physics class. They're expecting a lot of calculator-based assignments and that sort of thing. And I'm asking them to think big picture oftentimes. So we throw on learning outcomes on our syllabi. Here are mine. And here's different ways my assessment measures that I use. And so students are told that they're going to be writing a conference paper in order to achieve many of the objectives that I've set for the course. And so in the second level course, I have the students go through all facets of completing a professional conference paper, right up to the publication of a proceeding, which then the students get a copy of, and they can put it on their resume, and it goes as part of their portfolio. And one of the things about authentic assessment is really about coming up with activities that are going to really help them, you know, bridge the gap from the academy into the workforce. And no matter what field a person goes into, there's a very strong chance that they're going to be doing a lot of writing. In fact, I tell my students, you're going to do more than, you know, I have to do, and I think I do a lot. So we start with a call for papers. They submit an abstract. Here's the call for papers. I've had a website for years that I've used for this, and this year I actually went to a Blackboard format, and it worked very well. And so I'm going to continue with that. So I have that set up on Blackboard. So they have to choose a topic that relates to the material that we're covering in class. And I can share with you a few of the types of things that the students do. So this is a sample of an abstract, and then the nature of the feedback that you can kind of see what I'm giving the students. And this was a paper on the acoustic guitar. One of the students wrote a paper on the physics of the acoustic guitar. And go ahead. The students have formal guidelines that they have to follow for the paper. It's probably about 15 to 20 pages in a standard 12-point font, you know, double space type format. But the idea here is that I force the students to get the paper drafted before spring break so that they have that full 6 weeks to work on improving the writing and not that paper that comes in during finals week or the week before finals that the students never come back to pick up to see your comments. So you feel, and I know this feeling from both sides of the desk, why should I bother? Because I know that they're not going to come back and have a look at it. And the point is that I want to help them tease out any issues that they might have with their understanding before it's that, you know, we get to that point. So the first draft of the papers come in before break, and I give them extensive amount of feedback. This is the one piece that does take a little bit of time. And I should mention that the class size has been limited to 16, and if we continue to offer it, the enrollment will go up to 20. I know that it can be managed at a much larger level. It's being done elsewhere in a much larger level, modeled after this conference. And so what I'm trying to do is set the model, set the stage for what I expect the students when they do a review of one of their classmates' papers. So, you know, when they get, what I found is students aren't used to getting that much feedback. So some of them are really taken aback when they get it. But I say, move on. You know, let's have you have this be the best paper that you can possibly write. Second draft comes in, they have to follow professional guidelines, they have to give written feedback, they have to go through, should I accept, with major, minor revisions, etc. And then they go through, and this is the same student reviewing another student's paper, and the feedback that they give each other, and that happens after spring break. And finally, they get to the point, this is Jamie Darkin's paper, and this is his final copy, and it looks really nice, looks really professional. Students use this when they apply for internships, if they need a writing sample. I can't tell you how many students have come back and said, you know, this was a major topic during my interview, was why did you write this paper in a physics class, you know? And the fact that it was a physics class and they're a business major, it just looks really good for them at interview time. Here's the proceedings. Number of different topics. We had everything from physics of photography to, a lot of musical papers. I get some audio tech people that take the class, and just a number of different things. One paper I should tell you about was written a couple years ago by a student who did a sociology major with an applied physics minor, and she wrote a paper on cochlear implants and their impact on the deaf community. And that paper has served her very well, and she went on and did another project with me, and I took her to a conference this summer, and she was able to actually present at a real conference. So I've got a hustle here. Here's some of the students. I make them dress up. They get name tags. Mom and dad get a letter. They all come, that kind of thing. So I mentioned this earlier. One of the things with authentic assessment is I found the use of rubrics very helpful. So I'm going to have my assistant here flip through the rubrics. So I've created rubrics. If any of you are trying to do this and would like to have copies, just email me and I'll send them to you, or I can put them on Blackboard for the conference paper itself. I played with this one. I don't know if I have anybody from the college writing program here, but I adapted your rubric, and I'm trying to meet with students periodically during the semester to get them to have better scores on the rubric as we go along. So, and this is another shot of that same rubric. So if any of you are trying to use that rubric that they've got, it's fantastic, and this was my first semester working with it. They also do a peer review during the conference presentations. And that works out pretty well. And so in summary, I found that I can get a better handle on what my students are learning while the learning is taking place. It takes away some of the threat because they're not being tested, but they know that it's something that they really want to make look nice because it's going to serve another purpose for them later on. And so the professional aspect. And if you'll hit one more page down, back one. I think this is the key here. Is that the traditional methods really don't have a built-in mechanism for that, so I've gravitated to other mechanisms to try and help students correct the learning before it's too late. Okay. Let's just flip to the end. I'm using something called free writing activities. Stop. Free writing activities in both of my classes this semester. And let me just, I'll say one or two things and then move on to the last slide so that Joe can have his time. Free writing activities are something that are kind of like a reflective writing, if you've done anything like that, or even a journaling, but it's very different in the sense that it really depends on what's going on, and I change them up all the time. This one's called a context-rich activity because I situated it in a car accident, fender bender in Georgetown, and then I had the students finish telling the story, and they had to incorporate the physics into it and all of those sorts of things. But what I have found is if you take away the threat of the grade and just have them focus on the feedback, that's where the learning comes in. You know, if they get a 9 out of 10 on it, they're going to say, oh, I got a 90%. That's pretty good. They're not going to look at that feedback that I spent all this time writing because there's something still wrong with it because I took off a point. And so I don't even put a score on these babies until the end of the semester. And the students just know that they're banking the points, and they can even get the physics wrong and still get full points because I want them to be learning as we go. So that's a free writing activity. Some of the ways that I let students be creative, they do all kinds of things. They write poems, stories, plays, all that kind of stuff. Keep going. This is another one, a beach scenario. I'm trying to teach them some fluid mechanics. They do some creative things. They write cartoons, various things. Snowpocalypse, if we remember that. And so this is my class. They're so excited about writing, they just jump for joy. And I'll just finish it up again with my invitation. If you are in the neighborhood of SCAN, just come by and I will hook you up, okay? Thank you.
And at least this go around, you didn't need the coffee. I'm perked up and I'm sure the rest of you are as well, and thinking about ways of teaching that many of us have never envisioned. Thank you so much. The second award we are here to talk about and hear a recipient thereof is our Teaching with Research Award, which recognizes faculty who, quote, creatively incorporate original student research activities into course experience. We had two winners this past year. One of them, Professor Ed Stasek from SPA, is busy running a departmental orientation for PhD students today and therefore cannot join us. But we are delighted that the other person who won the award indeed is here, Professor W. Joseph Campbell, better known as Joe, is recognized for introducing hundreds of his students over the years to the rewards of conducting original research at the Library of Congress, for enabling students to gain familiarity with this exceptional research institution, and for encouraging students to draw insights from close examination of primary source material. In his spare time, Professor Campbell writes books. There are six of them since he has come to AU, and they've drawn on research, amazingly enough, at the Library of Congress. This year, he has a book coming out. Well, technically, it's the second of next year, called 1995, The Year the Future Began, and I am really curious to find what that title means, coming out with University of California Press. Joe.
Thank you, Naomi, and thank you, Anna, for organizing such a fine gathering. First question, can everybody see me okay? Just want to make sure, you know. I think I am the tallest faculty member, at least in this room, probably on campus, and I know in the School of Communication, which is my faculty home, tallest faculty member. And yes, of course, I did used to play basketball, and one time I was pretty good at it, actually, and I even played a year in Switzerland back in the day, but that's another story. You know, in Washington, we are really blessed, are we not, with all kinds of world-class institutions, research institutions, the Smithsonian, the National Archives, the Library of Congress. And it's a place, of course, where one can go and ooh and ah. I mean, the Jefferson Building of the Library of Congress is worth a journey. I think in the Michelin Guide it would be considered worth a journey, at least in my view, it's worth a journey. So it's a place for oohing and awing, for sure. And it's also a place, a world-class research institution, a great place to conduct research. And as Naomi mentioned, I have done a fair amount of research, including this forthcoming book about 1995 and The Year the Future Began. Very quickly, just a shameless self-promotion moment, if you won't mind. It takes a look at some of the watershed moments of that year, 20 years ago almost. It was the year in which the web went mainstream. Not everybody's online in 1995, but everybody knows about it, hears about it, begins to go online. The digital century can be traced in many respects to 1995. It was the year, of course, the O.J. Simpson trial, which spread like a stain, if you will, across the year, and led to the emergence of an understanding, a broad popular understanding and interest in DNA, forensic DNA evidence. It was the year of the Oklahoma City bombing and the beginning of imposition of restrictions on American life in many ways that we continue to live with. It was also the year of the Dayton Peace Accords, in which the United States brokered a foreign policy success, i.e. ending the vicious war in Bosnia that had been going on for nearly 4 years. And it was also the year, 1995, was the year when the government shut down, a partial shutdown in November 1995, which enabled Monica Lewinsky to meet Bill Clinton intimately. Another story. Back to the Library of Congress. Back to the Library of Congress. It can also be a place for student research, And one of the hurdles in getting over this notion for students is not only is it more, it's a metro right away, essentially. But it's also kind of an imposing place, a forbidding place in many ways. Whoa, the Library of Congress, he wants me to go down there to do research? I mean, come on, really? And it is, it's a forbidding place. And even architecturally, as impressive as the Jefferson Building is, which is one of three buildings on the Library of Congress campus on Capitol Hill, and the Jefferson Building, by the way, was opened in 1897, federal building under budget and ahead of schedule. It's an impressive building, but it's also, the architecture is imposing, you have to admit. So you have these obstacles to get over with students. But it can be done, and it can be done well. And earnestly, I must add. As Naomi mentioned, hundreds of my students over the years, I joined the faculty in 1997, and I came up with this assignment in 1998 or 1999. And since then, hundreds of my students have gone to the Library of Congress to conduct primary source research, typically using the vast collection of newspapers on microfilm in the newspaper and current periodical reading room of the Library of Congress. Occasionally, we've had an assignment that has taken them to the manuscripts reading room or other reading rooms, but typically, it's the newspaper and current periodical reading room. I used to ask them to go down there on their own. I found that that was, I guess, enhancing this forbidding notion of the Library of Congress. So I set aside class time, particularly in seminar classes. This works best in classes of 18 to 20. Block classes. So I take a block, we go down to the Library of Congress, we get acquainted, we get the reader's card, and we get going. We get going on the research. This is no time for oohing and aahing in the Jefferson Building. This is time in the Madison Building at the newspaper and current periodical reading room to start cranking microfilm, this old new technology for many students. So I help them thread the microfilm, show them how to turn the machine on, the reader, and get going. It's interesting. It's very interesting that many of the students find this fascinating. The microfilm is fascinating. As I say, it's an old, new technology. And you know, to have images up on the screen, you know, through this strip of film is novel. And I'm always amazed, but I'm willing to, you know, to go with it and say, yeah, this is cool. It's old, but it's still cool. And a lot of students find that this is, wow, how cool can this be? Here we are in Washington, D.C., doing research at the Library of Congress. And they really take this seriously, and they really find that, you know, this has a lot of appeal, doing research at the Library of Congress. So what does this accomplish? What does this assignment accomplish? Several objectives, I think, are fulfilled. One, obviously, is it allows them to gain firsthand familiarity with an only in Washington world-class research institution. That yes, as formidable and forbidding as the Library of Congress may seem, it can be managed. We can do research there. And it allows them, the assignment is not just to sit down there and crank microfilm. It's to do so with an eye toward preparing a research paper due toward the end of the semester, a substantial research paper. So it allows them to complete an original research project using primary source material. And allows them, encourages them, and requires them, in fact, to draw interpretations and analysis from the examination of that primary source material. And it also, and no small benefit here either, it allows me to share with them my profound appreciation for the Library of Congress, to show them where I have done a fair amount of my research over the years. And my respect for the Library of Congress, I think, is something that's very important to communicate to the students. And this assignment fulfills that objective as well. So what kind of research topics have we done over the years? There have been many. One was the coverage of the commencement speech that Kennedy gave here at AU in June of 1963. Was this a big story? How was it treated back in the day, back in June of 63? Interestingly enough, as important as the speech was, it wasn't the dominant news story of that week. There were civil rights issues going on. There were the first woman in space was blasted off in the Soviet Union. There were lots of things going on in this crowded week in June of 63 in which Kennedy gave his remarks at American University. We've also done research about how did the newspapers cover the famous or infamous War of the Worlds radio dramatization of 1938, Orson Welles' famous program in which supposedly the country was pitched into panic and mass hysteria because of this radio broadcast was so lifelike and so realistic that everybody thought it was real news being broadcast. Okay, how did newspapers cover that? It's another topic that we've looked at. Also taking a look at the coverage of the 1960 presidential debate, the first debate ever in a presidential election campaign in this country, Nixon-Kennedy. Okay, did they think Nixon looked like, you know, a zombie or whatever? Or just how was this covered? Get down and see what was being said about that. Interestingly, a number of papers, including the Washington Post, thought Nixon won that first debate, that he did a better job than Kennedy. Of course, the conventional wisdom has since become that Kennedy wiped Nixon out and hence probably won the election because of that debate performance. We've also looked at the assassination coverage of Kennedy in 1963. So there's all sorts of topics, slices of larger issues that can be done very well and very easily at the Library of Congress. Not all of these papers are just turned into me and sort of have no shelf life afterwards. One student a couple of years ago, a grad student, and this assignment can be adapted to graduate as well as undergraduate courses, Angela Levy repurposed her paper, posted it at the blog that she has, and then offered the blog post to the Real Clear History site, one of the Real Clear Politics sites, and Real Clear History posted it. In fact, it reposted her paper about the Boston Globe's coverage of the Nixon-Kennedy debate in 1960, not only in 2012, but in 2013. So these papers can have a bit of shelf life after the fact. And this young man, a undergraduate student in a class of mine last fall, he repurposed his paper about the Kennedy assassination coverage in a Salt Lake newspaper, repurposed it for a blog post that he offered to the Salt Lake paper, and they posted it. They posted it at one of their blogs. So these papers can have shelf life longer than and beyond just my reading them and returning them. So it is. This is a way to incorporate original student research and introducing them to a world-class research institution that's really in our backyard. So thank you, CTRL. Thank you for this award. Thank you for this recognition. And thank you for the opportunity to discuss it. I look forward to any questions that you may have about this project or any others. So my many thanks. It's been a pleasure.
ahead and set up a table and gave you name cards. Maybe if you're
Should
willing,
we?
You can stand, you may sit, you may do what you'd like, but at least by your own name. And we'll open things to questions. Yoga helps you keep your balance. So questions either for Teresa Larkin or for Joe Campbell. Take them in whatever order.
I'm going to be great work for both of you. Really inspirational.
Thank you, Larry.
You're welcome. I'm going to be sending my University College VisLit class to the Library of Congress, doing primary research more in the photography unit than in microfiche. But I'm now thinking that I can add value to the photography work by looking at reviews and commentary about the photographs or the photographers, or say what newspapers were writing about with the WPA. How often did you go down to the Library of Congress with your students?
Typically once. One visit during class time, which is the time, of course, I can say, yes, we all have to be there. And we meet at the library. We don't travel from campus. We meet at the entrance of the Madison Building, help them get through security, and then get their reader's card, which takes anywhere from 5 to 25 minutes, depending if there's a line of tourists who want a, you know, Library of Congress reader's card. Believe it or not, there are. There are many sometimes. So that will give us the better part of 2 hours to get the microfilm and to get going. I think in any assignment down there, it's a good idea to speak with the head of the respective reading rooms and to ask him or her, to explain what the assignment is and to say, what best way can we navigate the library's requirements and so forth, and get the get access to the material right away. So at the newspaper reading room, I asked the head of the reading room to pull the microfilm in advance. So we're not sitting around waiting for 25, 30 minutes to pass before the microfilm is delivered. It's already there in advance. So I think a little bit of pre-work is essential in terms of making the assignment work and making it click well. I also give the option to students to meet me at the library on the following Saturday. Say if it's a class that meets on a Tuesday or a Wednesday, I'll meet you, you know, at noon on Saturday here if you're interested in anything at all about this. You know, if you need further help or you know, want a little more one-on-one discussion, and if you want to visit the majestic main reading room of the Jefferson Building, I'll take a little tour over there too with them. So once for sure, once required, and once optional.
I'm going to borrow your microphone because I'm not going to take it off of Joe. Let me just add, we have another resource on this campus. Namely, our university librarian, Nancy Davenport, spent many, many years at the Library of Congress. So if you're considering starting a project for your students, she probably knows everybody and can help smooth the way, maybe make a short presentation in your class if there's something that's appropriate for her to talk about. So the resource works both ways.
Very good point, yes.
Yeah. Do you have a preset list of research topics that you give them before you go to the library?
I've done it both ways, and generally the latter. That yes, this is the topic that we'll be looking at, and why don't you choose a newspaper from your hometown or home state or a place you want to live someday, and we'll look at that. So it's a very narrow slice in many respects of a much broader topic, but it has the advantage of being manageable, doable, and inherently interesting to the students. So It's a bit more structured than I used to do it.
And one comment, just watching how you did this, Washington also has some very specialized libraries.
Absolutely.
The Department of Agriculture has a very extensive library research facility out in Beltsville. I know that the United States Postal Service has their own library at L'Enfant Plaza. So depending on your field of speciality, you might be able to take the same technique and take it into a different research facility.
That's a good point. That's a very good point. I also take many students to the museum, which is the Museum of News on Pennsylvania Avenue, and not so much to dig through their archives, of which they do have a fairly extensive archive, but to do an experiential, if you will, assignment that takes a look at some aspects of the museum's exhibits in a course-related way. So one course I teach is called Myths of the Media. These are about media-driven myths. And I have the students go there and poke around the exhibits for evidence of how media myths have incorporated or have infiltrated museum exhibits. So that's another option. Yeah, the city is full of these kinds of potential research and experiential learning assignments.
Okay, the next question is going to be for Terry Larkin.
This is actually for both of you because you've each logged impressive amounts of time at the university and developed really interesting projects. Tell us some of the lessons you've learned about grading students over the years. I think as a relatively new adjunct, that's probably the single most challenging dimension as we cope with this. So things you've learned, particularly since you're inspiring these students to do better in general. You know, how do you then finally get granular about who gets what grade?
I thought you were maybe thinking about the time element, you know, because that's a question that I typically get a lot when I do talks and workshops about writing, is just how much time that it takes. And, you know, no matter what type of system that we use, you know, there's a certain, I'm just going to say it, there's a certain amount of subjectivity that goes into it, and I try not to do that. And I try to be, when I issue a grade, I try to issue it in a more holistic fashion. You know, so in my Gen Ed 100 level courses, I'll start out by asking my students about, you know, just how they learn, and maybe even give them a learning style assessment and things like that. And I try to get a handle right away. I give them an extensive questionnaire that asks about their math background, their science background, all those sorts of things. So I get a handle on what they came in the door with, so that it's not just, you know, 90% get the A, 80% get the whatever, but to take a look at the individual and try to, you know, from where they started to where they ended. And, you know, the path isn't always straight up linear. It's sometimes like this. But it's very helpful. I think with the writing, I can do that because I have had students, especially students whose first language is not English, who typically struggle with pen and paper type, especially multiple choice type activities and things like that, that many of us gravitate to because we teach large classes, and then give them an assignment in which they can express themselves through language that isn't even their first language. You know, I'm thinking in particular of a woman who I had just never said anything in class, was getting C's on all the exams, but when I allowed her to write creatively about a topic, it was fluid mechanics, it happened to be. She wrote the most amazing poem about a physicist and his wife, and it was sort of stereotypical gender-wise, but she really nailed it, and I thought, you know, here's this student who has been sitting in my class all semester doing average work that has an above average understanding. So I've been able to use the writing to sort of say, you know what, this test really only acknowledged what you could do on one day in 75 minutes with a calculator and a pencil and no other resources, and it's really not very representative of the full picture. So the writing has helped me help me do that.
That's a good question. I think that obviously it's something that we all think about, no matter how many years we've been on a faculty, and it's an issue that never fades. Grade inflation has been much discussed, not only on this campus but elsewhere, for many years, and it continues to be front and center. I think one way to make grading, if not easier, then more coherent, is to make sure expectations are spelled out very clearly, not only in the syllabus but on the first day, the introductions of the first day, that you make it very clear what it is that you expect from the students in terms of their performance and how you're going to evaluate that performance. You're right, Terry. A lot of it is very subjective, I'm afraid. One way to manage that level of subjectivity, I think, is to require an early assignment, a very early assignment, maybe day one, perhaps, in which, and it's not heavily weighted, but it gives the students a chance to see how you evaluate their work, and you obviously want to return this very quickly within a week of their submitting it. And I think that gives them a sense of, okay, this is what he's looking for, this is how he's going to be evaluating me. I do very few exams. I maybe have a final exam in some of my seminar-style classes, but a lot of written work is required in my classes. And so I want to give students a sense right away of what it is I'm looking for and how they're going to be evaluated. And one way to do that is that like 5% reaction paper on day one is one thing that's helped, I think, manage expectations.
So I've tried to do some adventurous assignments and seminars, but nothing quite as adventurous as either of these. Can you talk a little bit about how you deal with students' resistance to unconventional types of assignments? I'm thinking particularly about the notion that I would present in a physics conference at the end of this class, I have students who say, man, can't I just answer 50 questions in an hour and get out of here?
I can just say a little bit about that, I guess. I have found that students at American University, one of the draws of even coming to American University is the opportunity to do something a little bit different, to craft a program. And, you know, I point blank try to tell the students that this is not about just that, giving you the pencil and paper, you know, the easy way out. I've lived my entire career mainly in large enrollment classes. And before I came to American, I taught in an engineering school and worked with, science and engineering majors. And that was the mentality, you know, show me the shortcut to get the solution so I can, you know, whatever. And I started doing writing even back when I was at the other institution. And I did get some resistance. But you know where I get the biggest amount of resistance is doing workshops from faculty, which is why I thought the other gal was going to ask about just the time commitment when you do writing activities, because I get more resistance from colleagues about how can I, you know, do this, how can I manage my time. And there are lots and lots and lots of tricks that you can use to make the time manageable. For example, with the free writing activities, if I'm giving two sections of the same course, I might give the activity as a kind of writing activity before we've even talked about a concept in class to one section, and give the same question to the other class after we've completed talking about it and they've done some homework. So there it gives me a marker, assuming that my classes are relatively similar, so I can see kind of where we were when we started and where we ended up and what else I still need to talk about in order to bring them to where I think they need to be if they're not where I think they need to be. So I've cut my time in half because I'm only doing half at a time, and I'm able to see something else in addition to that. And so it's really a matter of streamlining it, using rubrics. You can do a lot with rubrics to streamline it so that it doesn't take a huge amount of time, and it really depends on the purpose of the activity. But I try to tell students that it's not about doing that, it's about getting you out the door and making you a competitive individual. And I can guarantee to the students who take the class that I make them write a paper that they know going in that they're going to do that, and that's what they want, because, you know, we can put our students out there. How many other, you know, finance majors are going to be out there with a resume that says that they've written a pretty sophisticated for that level of class or student in a physics class? So it sets them aside from everybody else when it comes to, you know, just weighing the initial screening of applications. And so students want that. They want something different. They want to be able to impress the internship, the supervisor, the employer, whatever. So I don't get the resistance from the students really at all. In fact, they love that opportunity to do something different.
Yeah, I've not found much resistance to this assignment. I mean, it's like, okay, this is what we're going to do. There's no pushback on this. But nonetheless, I think any resistance can be addressed and countered by the enthusiasm that the instructor is showing. You know, I am an unabashed supporter of the Library of Congress. I love that place. I spend a lot of time there. And you know, I try to communicate that to the students, and that enthusiasm, that respect for this world-class research institution, I think it kind of rubs off on them too. And also to make it clear that this is just not a one-off visit necessarily, that you can expect to go back there on other assignments and other classes, or if you're working on the Hill, as many of our students do research, for Congress at the Library of Congress is certainly doable. So it has multiple options, and they seem to think that. So resistance tends to be fairly limited. And if you know what you're doing, if the assignment has been well prepared, well laid out, and you know the place that you're going to take them to off campus, I think it's very manageable. Any level of resistance can be countered.
We can do one more question. Who's going to have the last query?
Yeah, I just had, Teresa, a number of people have talked about this kind of, the idea of having a paper early that then students get feedback and continue to work on. I certainly have had the opposite to what you're talking about, where you get a paper at the end of the semester, I write lots of comments, I have no idea if they look at them or if they use them. My question, though, is, and I imagine, I teach economics, I imagine physics is really similar in the sense you're building up knowledge. So if you're assigning a paper partway, very early in the semester, how do you make sure that they have enough tools and building blocks to really write something useful and not feel like this whole second half of the course is not going to get incorporated in what they're doing?
Oh, that's a really good question. And what happens is I try to get students to choose topics that are going to serve them well in the long run. And so some students choose topics that are related to material that we aren't going to cover. For example, a student that wants to write about film and photography and things like that, we aren't going to physically get to those topics until later in the term. And so it really does allow them to be real researchers in that respect, because they have to work ahead. And a lot of them choose topics even though they know that they aren't going to be talked at in class or have done anything yet in class. And so a lot of, and I provide them, I help them if they're doing a topic like that with additional resources and sort of steer them in the right direction. But I think that they find that it's still a very meaningful experience, because they have to embark on, the project from square one, having had, in the second level course. I wouldn't do this in a first level course, because the second level course, I know that they've taken a first level course and they have a certain number of tools. And in my discipline, we are constantly, for 30 years, we have never stopped the conversation about, do I teach all the chapters in the book, or should I cut it down and do a little bit less and do it better. And I have been in the less is more camp for a really long time. and the bottom line is, it's the tools that they learn no matter what the topic is, right? That we want, it's those skills that we want them to take with them, and not can they calculate, a momentum change after a collision 20 years from now, but the tools that they needed to calculate the momentum change. I love my colleague there. I was waiting for something, Nate, so you didn't let me down. but I think that, does that answer your question? So I really, they don't mind, because they've had the tools, they know enough physics to do it, and I don't let them pick a topic that's so far out there that I know they're going to run into just, enormous amount of math or something like that, so.
So there was a free lunch, but there is something that we want from you, please. There's a little evaluation form that either you have or somebody will give you a copy of. If you please fill it out, that will help us as we build our programming in future years. Thank you very, very much, Teresa Larkin.